The grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you. Good morning and welcome to West End Presbyterian Church. I'm Dave Andrews and one of the elders here at the church. I have a few announcements this morning. We've been announcing or putting in the bulletin that if you need congregational care, there's some contact numbers there. And I also want to say that recently the session decided that it would be important for us to have a pastor available if folks needed pastoral care. And we have arranged with Reverend Jane Love to do that. If you feel like you would like to have a conversation with her, either by phone or in person, please contact Carol McDonald first and check with Carol, and she'll make those arrangements. Also, some additional news from session. We are looking at changing our model, sort of, as far as pastors go, going from an installed pastor to what we call a stated supply. And this is something that we've been working on in the last month or so. We hope that that's a situation where the individual's on an annual contract. And we're hoping to have some more information about that in the next couple of weeks. We're looking forward to possibly a really good opportunity here. So bear with us and stay tuned. Also want to mention that one of our members, Mike Harubi, will be leaving us and moving back to Pennsylvania. And there is scheduled for Sunday, August 18th, a chance to celebrate him and honor him as he moves back to Pennsylvania. Heading into the fall, we have a lot of exciting things happening, and one of which is the choirs are going to crank back up again. And Bev has got some good plans ahead for everybody. And bear in mind, we have on the 21st, she has a covered dish dinner, and she just told me that she's found some chicken, so she's going to be supplying fried chicken for that. So bring a salad or a side dish or a dessert for those of you that are interested in being in the choir. And it's really open to anybody that wants to be a part of the choirs or support the choirs. And we look forward to that. Also, being in this time of the year in the fall, the Cub Scouts are cranking back up. And of course, we charter pack number 98. So if you know of any kindergartners through fifth grade that are interested in Cub Scouts, now's the time to get them signed up. We appreciate having with us this morning several musicians. Dr. Darrell Simpkins on the violin, and the vocalists are Johnie Marion and Mike Marion, and we appreciate y'all being with us today so much. We also appreciate Gabe Bucky Holmes, who is with us again. He was here on June 2nd, and he is a commissioned ruling elder in the Presbyterian Church USA, as well as doing that, he's assistant admissions director at Duke University. And currently he's been pretty busy on his weekends serving First Presbyterian Church in Dunn, having the worship service there. And so we are really fortunate to have you back with us, and we appreciate you spending time with us. Are there any other announcements at this time?
Thank you. Let us join in the call to worship, which is printed in your bulletin. Rejoice, people of God. This is our Sabbath day. God ordained the Sabbath, rest, and restoration. God is worthy of worship, our creator, healer, and inspiration. So then, let us worship God. Please stand as you are able, joining in singing our opening hymn, number 396, Brethren, We Have Met to Worship.
You may be seated. If we say we are without sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God will be faithful and just. Please join me now as we say together our prayer of confession. Gracious God, in the stopping, in the pausing, in the quiet, we cannot avoid what we are not. Our faults, our lack of faith, our lack of vision and action, our lack of trust, all bubble to the surface.
You, Lord God, see who we are and stay the same by us,
offering us hope and all forgiveness. Accept our confession and grant us your grace. Friends, God's promise is sure. In Christ, we are forgiven. Rejoice in God's strength and live in Christ's light.
Thank you.
Let us pray together the prayer for illumination. Almighty God, by your Holy Spirit, illumine the sacred page, we pray, that our minds may be open to receive your word, our hearts taught to love it, and our wills strengthened to obey it. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our first scripture reading today comes from the book of Exodus, chapter 31, verses 12 through 17. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. The Lord said to Moses, "You yourself are to speak to the Israelites. You shall surely keep my Sabbaths, for this is a sign between me and you throughout your generations, given in order that you may know that I, the Lord, sanctify you. You shall keep the Sabbath because it is holy for you. Everyone who profanes it shall be put to death, and whoever does any work on it shall be cut off from among the people. 6 days shall work be done, but the seventh day is a day of solemn rest, holy to the Lord. Whoever does any work on the Sabbath day shall be put to death. Therefore, the Israelites shall keep the Sabbath, observing the Sabbath throughout their generations as a perpetual covenant. It is a sign forever between me and the Israelites that in the 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, and on the seventh day he rested and was refreshed." The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
My faithful Father,
Well, between Megan's time with the children and that music, I'm not sure you need me here. That was beautiful. Our gospel lesson today comes from Luke. It's chapter 13, verses 10 through 17. Listen for the word. Now, he was teaching in one of the synagogues on the Sabbath. And just then there appeared a woman with a spirit that had been crippled for 18 years. She was bent over and was quite unable to stand up straight. When Jesus saw her, he called her over and said, "Woman, you are set free from your ailment." When he laid his hands on her, immediately she stood up straight and began praising God. But the leader of the synagogue, indignant because Jesus had cured on the Sabbath, kept saying to the crowd, "There are 6 days on which work ought to be done. Come on those days to be cured and not on the Sabbath day." But the Lord answered him and said, "You hypocrites! Does not each of you on the Sabbath untie his ox or his donkey from the manger and lead it away to give it water? And ought not this woman, a daughter of Abraham, who Satan has bound for 18 years, be set free from this bondage on the Sabbath day?" When he said this, all his opponents were put to shame, and the entire crowd was rejoicing at the wonderful things he was doing. The word of God for the people of God. Although the weather certainly knows it, it's hard to believe that we're already looking toward the end of summer. And as attendance tends to show this time of year, we're in the midst of the season of vacation and some well-deserved rest. And it's well-deserved because when we spend our time and good energy living out our faith, there are times when we need and deserve a break. And that's what summer vacation is all about, and that's what Sabbath is about as well. In our Old Testament lesson today, we hear God tell Moses to speak to the Israelites and let them know that he is serious about keeping the Sabbath, and that if they take their covenant lightly, they will be put to death. Then the passage ends with, "In 6 days the Lord made the heavens and earth, and on the seventh day he rested and was refreshed." Seems pretty straightforward to me. And who wouldn't like to be rested and refreshed these days? But the passage from Luke is a little more complicated, yet it has the same message. In this text, Jesus is teaching in the synagogue as usual. And then there appears a woman who has been crippled for 18 years and for all that time has been bent over and not able to stand up straight. Jesus sees her and says, "Woman, you are set free from your ailment." And when he laid hands on her, she stood up straight and began praising God. At this point, the leaders of the synagogue are upset because he is cured on the Sabbath. It's interesting, though, the rabbis do not go after Jesus, but target the woman instead, saying, "There are 6 days for work to be done, so come in on one of those days to be cured, not on the Sabbath." But here's the thing. This woman didn't approach Jesus to heal her. She was there to worship just like everybody else. It just happened that Jesus saw her and had compassion and acted on it. Then Jesus uses a characterization that's cited a lot in Luke, calls the rabbi saying, "You hypocrites, does not each of you on the Sabbath untie your ox or donkey and lead it to water? So why wouldn't this woman be set free from her bondage on the Sabbath?" When they hear this, the opponents are put to shame and the crowd rejoices. And looking at commentaries on this passage, I find it interesting that most concentrate either on keeping the Sabbath or on healing the woman. But in my mind, they're distinctly related. After all, isn't healing and restoration the whole idea? In those days, things were a little more black and white, and strict religious rules were the order of the day. But in our times, it seems things have become a little grayer. I remember when I was growing up, most businesses were closed on Sundays, and for the ones that were open, there were blue laws that prevented you from buying any number of things, including school supplies, which I discovered one Sunday when I'd procrastinated on a school assignment that was due on Monday. We all need our Sabbath, but it's not always wrapped up in a neat package or dictated by what we can or can't buy on a Sunday. And our modern, connected, fluid lives make it harder and harder to carve out time just to breathe. At the beginning of every week, I try to take a look at my calendar so I can have a pretty good grip on what's coming and where I need to be and when. I did that a few weeks ago and thought I was in pretty good shape and thought I was going to have some downtime later in the week. Then on that Monday, I heard that a longtime member at Barbecue Church, where I previously served, had passed away. And then on that Wednesday, another longtime member and friend died unexpectedly, and the family asked if I could help with the service. Suddenly, my week's plans began to change, and I was going to be involved in funerals on Saturday and Sunday. But even with some necessary adjustments and schedule changes, it all came together in the end. So you might be thinking, what does that have to do with our scripture today? Well, I think it relates in a couple of ways. On that Sunday, there was some healing done on the Sabbath at Barbecue Church. Maybe not literally, but the congregation came together, showed up as a community, and lifted up a family in pain and showed what it is to be children of God celebrating one of our own. And it's also a reminder that we don't always get to be the one in control of our schedule and our lives. And sometimes we have to adjust and have our Sabbath in unplanned ways. But just because life comes at us in ways we don't expect and plays with our schedule doesn't excuse us from taking time to take care of ourselves. How does it go that the times when you think you least have the opportunity to rest are the times that you need it the most? The thing is to spend time with yourself to explore the ways that rest can be most meaningful to you. In a service from Alfred Street Baptist Church in Alexandria, Virginia, which, by the way, designates the month of August as the month of rest, Reverend Zena Jacques talks about four different terms in Scripture that translate to Sabbath and how they might relate to our lives. The first three are verbs, and the last is a noun. The first is Shabbat. It means to cease, to rest, to stop laboring. For us, I think it means to take a break from the rat race, unplug. It means don't work, but it also means don't do laundry or tidy up or do anything that resembles a chore. After all, God created the earth, heavens and earth in 6 days, and on the seventh day took a rest. So why can't we follow that example? The second word is saquat. In text, it means undisturbed. It's described as when the land is at peace. No war external to the people of God when they are surrounded by peace. For us, it means letting go of all the external distractions, taking a break from that and those that call our minds away from rest. In Jacques' illustration, she says that caller ID is of God, and when you see certain names come up, you should just saquat, that you must rest from all that is outside you. The last verb is samat. This means to release, let go, and drop. While saquat deals with external distraction and conflict, samat addresses the internal, letting go of those internal thoughts that prevent our heart and mind from gaining true rest. And finally, there is the noun manoek. This is a literal resting place, a place where you go for peace. It may be by the sea, or on a lake, or in the mountains by a soothing stream, or as Jacques describes it in her hectic household, the bathroom door locked with a sock on the outside knob that means leave me alone, this is my time. So Shabbat, Saquat, Samat, and Monaic. They are all important and interrelated. Resting from work, getting away from the external noise that distracts us, centering ourselves so we can have some inner peace, and finding that place where we can retreat undisturbed. It all sounds good, but where do we find the time in our busy schedules to do all that? After all, we have jobs to do and mouths to feed and other people counting on us. It can feel a little desperate at times, but that's when we need it more than ever. Episcopal priest Adam Thomas describes a place of sanctuary for him in North Carolina mountains that's an annual retreat. He says, "Over the years, this final reason has crept up the list of why I love going to Canuga. No cell phone and no internet at Canuga means less distraction and more time with family. Less comatose web browsing and more time with a physical book in my hands. Less mindless iPhone gaming and more time napping. Canuga is a place of Sabbath for me, a place of rejuvenation and refreshment and freedom from that which keeps me bound. Sabbath is a dedicated time to gather awareness of new life and funnel it toward greater freedom." He goes on to say, "God created Sabbath because God knew that we would kill ourselves with our mangled priorities. God knew our healthy love for things could easily mutate into unhealthy bondage to things. God knew that we would be so consumed by the act of doing that we'd forget the act of simply being. When Jesus spars with the leader of the synagogue, Jesus reminds him that the Sabbath means more than just a prohibition from work. Sabbath means a flourishing of freedom." Besides providing the freedom that Thomas describes, keeping Sabbath might also be our physical salvation. According to an article in NIH Library of Medicine, it states, "Emotional stress is a major contributing factor to the 6 leading causes of death in the United States, and chronic stress exerts a general immunosuppressive effect that suppresses or withholds the body's ability to initiate a prompt, efficient immune reaction. In Exodus, when God says, "Everyone who profanes the Sabbath shall be put to death," maybe it doesn't mean that God's going to strike them with a lightning bolt if they don't practice self-care. But maybe in the end, if we don't, we're actually killing ourselves. That all sounds pretty serious because, frankly, it is. When Moses was on Mount Sinai, God didn't give him the 10 suggestions. He gave him the 10 commandments. And keeping the Sabbath is in the top 5. Remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. Adam Haschel comments, "The first holy thing in all creation was not a people or a place, but a day. God made everything in creation and called it good, but when God rested on the seventh day, God called it holy. He said, that makes the seventh day a palace in time with a kingdom for all into which human beings are invited every single week of our lives." In our story today, finding Sabbath isn't easy, but it is necessary. We work and do and serve and text and respond and post so much, but when do we ever really shut down and rest? We may not be able to take a full day every week, and there may be weeks when we can't take time at all, but we have to stay aware of our need to take care of ourselves. I currently serve on the Commission on Ministry for the Presbytery, and one of the primary functions of this commission is to examine candidates for positions in ministry. The questions vary depending on the position and the candidate and the congregation they may serve, but the one question that is asked of every candidate is, how do you practice self-care? And if a candidate doesn't have a good answer, then it's something that we address. Barbara Brown Taylor puts it this way: at least one day in every 7, pull off the road and park the car in the garage. Close the door to the tool shed and turn off the computer. Stay home not because you were sick, but because you were well. Talk someone you love into being well with you. Take a nap, take a walk, and an hour for lunch. Test the premise that you are worth more than you can produce. That even if you spent one whole day of being good for nothing, you would still be precious in God's sight. And when you get anxious because you are so convinced that this is not so, remember that your own conviction is not required. This is a commandment. Your worth has already been established, even when you were not working. The purpose of the commandment is to woo you to the same truth. And so, I think we are called to enjoy this season we're in. And if you can, take a week or a day or an afternoon or an hour or even a few minutes in the morning or a few minutes in the evening. Go outside, away from distraction. Look around you or up if it's night and breathe. Breathe out the cares of this world and breathe in the Spirit of God, which always, always surrounds us. And that, my friends, is Sabbath, one breath at a time. Amen. Now please stand, if you're able, as we say what we believe in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. Let us pray. God of grace, we give thanks for this day, this family of worship, and even for the rain of this past week. We give thanks that your presence is always in our midst. As we are now in the season of vacations and weddings and reunions, we ask for your blessing on travelers and their journey to be with family and friends, and as they discover new wonders in your world. And we give thanks for the Sabbath, a time for us to rest and breathe and reflect. We ask your blessings on our Sabbaths in whatever form they take, for they are dedicated time in your presence. We know that you comfort the brokenhearted, calm the terrified, and find the lost and remind them of the gift of your eternal presence. Wrap the mantle of your Spirit around the shoulders of those overwhelmed by fear and distress. And for those who cannot see a path forward, shine your light. Trusting in your gracious presence through all the peaks and valleys of our lives, we pray these prayers and all the prayers in our hearts in the name of your Son. Amen. We have been given much, and now is our opportunity to give back as we continue worship, receiving our tithes and offerings. us pray. We offer our gifts to you, Lord, with grateful, cheerful hearts. Thank you that you meet our needs where we are, providing what we need when we need it. Trusting you, we can share what we have with others, and we do this joyfully together. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Friends, we are here today because Jesus has called us, strangers and friends, locals and visitors, believers and doubters, the certain and the curious. It is always a mixed company that Jesus gathers and invites to his table, where in bread and wine he meets us. And through him, who are different, all are joined together as one. So come, not because you understand, but because you are understood. Come, not because of how you feel, but because God has food for you. Come not because you deserve a place, but because Jesus invites you just as you are. This table is for everyone. Let us pray. God of the resurrection, we give thanks that we are gathered around this table in your name to remember the pain and suffering of the cross, and to remember that it is your love and sacrifice that allows us to live. We give thanks that by your wounds we are healed, and we give thanks that we can say with great hope, it is finished, for we know what is still to come. You have given us life and second birth, and in your Spirit. Once we were no people, but now we are your people. You claimed Israel as your chosen nation and raised up the church as a witness to the resurrection, breathing into your life and power. From worlds apart, you gathered us together. When we go astray, you welcome us home. Gracious God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon us and upon these gifts of bread and wine, that the bread we break and the cup we bless may be the communion of the body and blood of Christ. By your Spirit, unite us with the living Christ, that we may be one in ministry in every place. That this bread is Christ's body for us, send us out to be the body of Christ in the world. We ask this in the name of the risen Son, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Jesus, on the night of his arrest, took bread, and after he had blessed it, he broke it, and he gave it to the disciples, and he said, Take, eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And in the same way, he took the cup, saying, This cup is the new covenant, sealed with my blood. Whenever you drink it, do this in remembrance of me. Every time you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the saving death of the risen Lord until he comes. The gifts of God for the people of God.
Of all wonders the world has ever known, above all wealth and treasures of the earth, there's a way to measure what you're
Let us pray. Gracious God, may we who have received this sacrament live in the unity of your Holy Spirit, that we may show forth your gifts to all the world. We ask this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Now please stand if you're able for our final hymn, number 803. Friends, go out on this holy Sabbath and breathe in the Spirit of God. And now may the grace of Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you today and always. Go in peace.